What's going on, guys? Welcome to Everything Always. My name's Michael Roman. Last night, we finally got the first two episodes of WandaVision, and there were a ton of Easter eggs. We're going to do our normal weekly recap, walk you through the episodes, explain what happened, point out slight Easter eggs where we can find them. Of course, we'll cover them throughout the weeks as we do deep dives, other Easter eggs and theories as they pop up. But for now, what you can expect on Fridays is a full episode recap. Today, we'll do one and two since they were released simultaneously, and we'll touch on Easter eggs, main narrative points, and what's going on with the characters and development towards the end of the show. The post-credit scene, or should we say the last scene in the first episode, definitely had some reveals, along with that scene you just saw there from episode 2. We're going to break it all down, but first, if you could grab the subscribe button, we're still giving away a PlayStation 5 as well as weekly and random Disney Plus subscriptions now that WandaVision has launched. If you want to be entered to win, all you have to do, hit that subscribe button, then leave a comment down below, and if you want, stick around to the end of the video. We'll get into all the giveaway stuff again there. So a couple of things I'm going to point out while we talk about the recaps, but I want you guys to keep two themes in mind. The first of all is the impending danger or impending doom. You see this iterated a ton throughout the show. The second of which is that the show is meant to be meta, and where there's an opportunity, they put allegory in, meaning something is meant to represent something else, and then not only a secondary representation, but a tertiary. Sorry if you're starting to feel like you're a little bit in English class, but that's the fun of these shows. And this show is definitely operating on multiple levels, not just the surface level of what's going on. You see this basically in the very first scene where they're joking around and Wanda says, "My husband and his very indestructible head," which obviously we all know from Infinity War, his head is absolutely not indestructible, or she could have been referring to the Infinity Stones that were seemingly destroyed, but now all of a sudden is back and present in this alternate reality. Now the show starts with them realizing that there's a heart on the 23rd of the calendar, yet both Wanda and Vision can't figure out what that date must mean. Now later Vision will go to work, he figures out that his boss, Mr. Hart, is coming over for dinner that night. That's what the heart on the calendar meant, and there's a mix-up in communication when he calls Wanda to vent about it, and seemingly they understand each other. Now Agnetha Harkness, the neighbor, has now poked in, and you can see there's something very interesting going on here. She really wants to help, she really wants to be involved, but she feels a little antsy and a little on edge. You see that later iterated when she pops her nose in while Wanda's trying to make dinner and just won't leave. Now eventually when Vision gets home, obviously there's a mix-up and a misunderstanding, but they are magical beings who are able to fix things at the drop of a hat. And that's the first thing I want to point out during this episode. It actually happens in the first two episodes. Wanda and Vision go out of their way to verbally say their powers over and over again. They enumerate them several times during the episodes. You hear it in the very first scene. Vision reminds her that he's incapable of forgetting. He's referred to as a computer during that office scene. There are a ton of opportunities for them to explain their own power set, and this works on two levels. The first of which goes to show you they are still self-cognizant. Even though they have no idea what's going on around them or how they got in this reality or really what's happening to them, they still know who they are and what they're capable of. The second thing is it's a little bit of false action for brand new Marvel fans, and they're expecting to pick up some along the way. Maybe you're a fan of Marvel, but now your girlfriend and or your friend or maybe your mother or dad are sitting there watching it with you on Disney Plus. They have no idea who these characters are. Well, if you have Wanda and Vision explaining what their powers are a couple of times through the first couple of episodes, that just helps catch everybody up. And I will expect that there's going to be a lot of that in the early episodes for some of these characters that we're all super familiar with, but maybe the lay fan isn't. Now, what is the third act of this 30-minute television show actually reveals two important things, both in theme and motivation. A, what's the important theme of the show? And B, what's the motivation of these characters that are sort of orbiting our main antagonists? And you see this play out in a couple of different ways. First of all, Wanda is struggling to make dinner in the kitchen. She's using too much or too little magic. When she tries to hit the chicken, she overdoes it, and then she tries to undo it and turns it all the way back into eggs. Basically, that's going to show you that no matter what Wanda does, she has a ton of magic. It is super powerful, and she's struggling to control it, basically creating this reality as well. And you hear this iterated by Vision's boss, "I had high hopes for you." He says, quote, "But you have all this chaos in your house," literally referring to the chaos magic that WandaVision has. Now you hear Vision desperately in the living room trying to entertain these two guests while Wanda tries to whip up all of that stuff in the kitchen, Vision starts singing Yakety Yak, the song that he originally heard playing during the office in the middle part of this episode. Why is Yakety Yak important? Well, guys, Yak, Goathead, this is one of the very clear first references to the devil, and throughout the two episodes that just aired, there are a million of them. I'm going to do my best to point them out, especially in the second episode, literally one every 2 minutes. Yakety Yak is definitely what the words are supposed to do. They're invoking the image of a goat, which typically, in a lot of religious and pop culture depictions, stands for the devil. Now, while Wanda is struggling with her magic, Agnetha Harkness shows up to help. You guys get it? The theme and the intention is right there. And another intention, iterated by her boss, when finally she gets dinner on the table, he's asking immediately about what their story is. This is Vision's boss, and why they don't have children. Why they don't have children. More intentions from the characters orbiting this main two couple. And by the end of the second episode, of course, we know that Wanda is pregnant. Now, there may be a ton of little Easter eggs throughout the first episode that I haven't quite touched on here. And as I said, throughout the week, we're going to do deep dives and get into theories, specific scenes, specific Easter eggs. But for now, this is meant to generally just go over a recap of the episode. But we have to talk about the final scene and then the post-credits before we jump to episode two. The first of which is that we actually zoom out of the television and it shows this episode playing on a TV set inside of a sword base and someone's writing in a journal watching it. And then it cuts to the post-credit scenes, which are the same for every episode and actually hold their own meaning, which we'll touch on in just a second. Now, one of the most common held theories about this show is that one of the villains, in fact, could be Nightmare, the original rumored villain for the Multiverse of Madness, which we know will end this trilogy, WandaVision, Spider-Man 3, and then Doctor Strange in the Multiverse of Madness, ending this through narrative. However, I'm pretty sure that all of these devil references are pointing directly to Mephisto. There are a ton of them. We even saw Easter eggs in other trailers we got during that Investors Day meeting. What's really interesting about this, though, is that S.W.O.R.D. sort of knows what's going on in a way that Wanda doesn't. We hear a S.W.O.R.D. agent later in episode 2 asking over the radio, "Who's doing this to you?" We see S.W.O.R.D. trying to break in both with the beekeeper and the helicopter. But what's interesting about this is they seem to have a readout on her mind. Look at the screens to the left there and the panels. I often conjectured that if not Mephisto, it could be that Wanda is actually in a coma and or sleeping somewhere in this S.W.O.R.D. base and then manifesting this outside reality. But through their means of observation, they're able to see what she's generating in her head as these episodes, and we're watching what they're watching on their own screen. Basically, we're watching Wanda's vision. Remember, I told you guys moments ago, this is an allegory. It is operating on a ton of levels. WandaVision, yes, Wanda, Mrs. Vision, but WandaVision, these are the visions Wanda is having in this pocket reality that could be being influenced by Nightmare if she is truly asleep. And for the post-credit scenes, you'll notice the green, the red, and the blue sort of pixelated dots everywhere. That's exactly what they are. Those are meant to replicate the original colors on a television set. I know you guys know the primary colors are red, blue, and yellow, but when it comes to light, the primary colors are red, blue, and green. Yeah, I know it kind of feels like a high school class. A couple of times through these videos, it is. And so all of this pixelation in the post-credit scene is just meant to replicate and show that they're inside of a television show and that this is being broadcast through a TV screen, which is only shown in red, green, and blue lights. And of course, if you've ever bought an expensive but vintage TV, you've had to go ahead and sort of correct those lights in the background. Only people my age will remember that. So the second episode really starts to pick up. There's the huge bangs at the beginning and the jokes about the helicopter that Wanda then finds later in the rose bushes. We figure out that the helicopter's probably coming through that barrier. That's the huge bang that we're hearing. And we find out that they're going to have a magic show, which is interesting because there are already two witches and or have magical powers, but they're going to do fake magic. That's when Wanda says something to Vision that is super interesting. And remember, working allegorically from the inside out, everything in a real magic show is fake. And that's interesting because her magic is most definitely real, but everything in this created reality is fake. So she's not only talking about the fact that when you do a card trick, it's not actual magic, it's fake, you're just using illusion and or tricking someone, but the fact that her magic, which is actually real, is creating this entire fake reality. And guys, this is woven into so much of these scenes. There's also something going on with numerology throughout these scenes. You'll see two rabbits in one place, three sort of butterflies in another, something about animals and numerology. But with the limited number of episodes we have here, I wasn't able to work out anything with the numbers in the system, but stay tuned for that. Now, going into this magic show, we figure out that she has to impress someone named Dottie, and it, again, it's just working towards the angle of there always being some sort of anxious thing going on, being on edge. You see that with the announcements of both the Stark Tech in episode one and then the Hydra Watch in episode two, sort of mid-episode commercials that are definitely meant to replicate old school commercials of the time. But then think about those two commercials particularly. Number one, with the Stark Tech and the blinking red light made to emulate the Stark Tech bomb that actually blew up her house. And then the Strucker watch in episode two, Strucker taking control of her and forcing her into a magic show, the same way it's playing out during episode two of the story. Remember guys, metaphor and allegory. What's going on in WandaVision is meant to replicate what's already happened in Wanda Maximoff's life. All of this magic and power forced onto her then meant she has to sort of perform and or earn the approval of the people around her. She went from being in Sokovia with her family and wanting to kill Tony Stark to all of a sudden being a part of the Avengers living in the United States. And you'll remember right after she joins that team, the Sokovia Accords come down and then she's sequestered to house confinement and has to be busted out by Hawkeye and then considered an enemy of the state and has to go on the run. Think about what that would mean for her as a person, and we're seeing that anxious nature and all these expectations of her and her magic, something that she was forced into anyway, play out in one little allegory during this episode. Guys, if your head is spinning, so is mine. Not what I expected from a Marvel show, but I love to see them operating on this level, especially for a complex character like Wanda Maximoff herself. Now, when Vision goes to that watch party sort of meetup, which just turns into be basically the guys gossiping, there's another immediate devil reference when he gives him a stick of Big Red. Get it? Big Red, the devil? Yeah, I'm sure you guys drew that conclusion yourself. And if you missed it, cheers to you. I was watching this in the middle of the morning as well, having to rewind 15 seconds to be like, wait a minute, was that another devil reference? Eric Voss over at New Rockstar said it was all going to be Mephisto probably 100 times in the last 6 months, and who knew, he was right almost every time. Now, it's funny how he gets drunk off of the gum, right? It gets up in his system, and they do that little cartoon, and then he acts as if he's drunk. So when he shows up to the magic show after Wanda has had that interruption over the radio, and we hear him saying, Wanda, who's doing this to you? And we see another flash of color in Dottie's hand, sort of revealing what's behind the screen. They have a magic show, Vision's drunk, and starts using his powers. Now, Wanda is anxiously trying to sort of hide the fact that he has actual magical powers, so she creates the rope to see that he's flying. When he lifts the piano, she turns it into paper. The idea is she just wants to fit in. She wants to hide what's underneath. The other idea is that the getting in of Vision, the Big Red, the introduction of this character who's orbiting but has influence and motivation, is sort of putting his hand on it, which is what's going on in this fake reality, also manifested out of magic, just like the magic show. God, our English teachers would be so proud of us. Anyway, they get through the magic show in much way they get through the dinner, which is no way at all, and basically just make a fool of themselves the entire time, go by the seat of their pants. However, everything turns out fine, right? The audience stands up and cheers for them in the same way that when his boss leaves dinner in the first episode, he says he's impressed and we'll talk about the promotion. Now, we can clearly see everything is amiss and it's utter chaos. There's chaos again, but from the inside out, everything always just goes well, and they sort of understand that they bombed. Again, they're self-cognizant, but the reality is playing towards them. So it's sort of this weird, no matter what they do, they can't fail. There must be something else at play. Again, Mephisto, large at hand in a lot of these episodes. We see that beekeeper get out of the manhole cover at the end of the episode. Wanda sees him and clearly says no. Not okay, not as powerful as No More Mutants, which she says during the House of M, which this is drawn directly from. But she says no and has the power to rewind this reality back to the moment where she discovered she was pregnant and then play it out from there. And it sort of put me in mind of Spawn as he uses his power one step closer to being returned to the devil. As she used her power, it exacerbates what's going on in this reality. It peels one layer away. The color is shown what's going on. And as she used her power there, she's pregnant now, one step closer to the devil's intentions. And guys, as I was doing this video right now, I actually started to think about some of the numerology in these episodes. You'll see on the helicopter, 3003, and then the number 57 on the other side. 3 plus 3 is 6. 5 and 7, the number in the middle, is 6. The address on the house, 2800 Westview, that's 8 minus 2 is 6. The numerology here may actually be for the devil, 666. 6 is everywhere, and I'll have to go back and look, but it's crazy as I was going through some of the screenshots for this and doing this video, as I've been talking to you guys, I've literally been putting that together in my head. Holy moly, I wonder how true that is. We'll have to go back and go on a 6 hunt, but now seeing some of these still shots, I'm thinking that's exactly what the numerology heads towards. It's all about the sixes, which really means it's all about Mephisto. Way to go, Eric. You've literally been calling this for months, buddy. I'm proud of you. Guys, let me know all your thoughts down below. Did you see any of this allegorical stuff while you were watching it? And does this video better help you do that in the future? Always be thinking about the metaphor with the show, especially when it's in these sort of sitcom trope episodes. As we get towards the end and it looks more like a Marvel movie, I suspect it'll become a lot more closer to the genre we're used to for the Avengers. But in the meantime, this is a whole nother level of storytelling, and I'm super, super into it, Marvel. Well done. Let's get into the giveaway stuff before I let you go. We're still giving away a PlayStation 5 at 800,000 subscribers, as well as a ton of Disney subscriptions. And if you're asking how we're going to do the Disney Plus subscriptions, we'll probably just pay for a year. I'll give you like a Visa gift card to cover a full year's subscription. And if you want to go spend it on doilies and bobbleheads, that's up to you. Is that what the kids still spend their money on? Either way, if you want to be entered to win any of the future prizes here at the channel, including doilies and bobbleheads. Okay, we're not giving away doilies and bobbleheads. We're going to have some awesome stuff. All you have to do to be entered to win, hit the subscribe button. You got to be a subscriber. Then leave a comment down below. The more videos you comment on, the better chance you have of winning, because it's completely random. Then hit the notification bell with notifications turned on to keep up with the videos. And of course, smash, hit, grab, or just basically touch the subscribe button. My name is Michael Roman. You can find me over on Instagram and Twitter under I Am Fires. You can find me on Spotify with original music, including the two songs you heard during this video, over on All Fires. Or you can find me on Twitch, twitch.tv/Novellin. Thanks for checking out the channel, guys, and stick around. We'll be posting again real soon.